Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. In today's video, I will show you how to implement the equals and hashcode methods of your entities. You will learn how to implement these methods so that they fulfill the requirements of the Java language, the JPA specification, and Hibernate. I will also show you which attributes you should never include in your equals method. My consulting clients and people in my workshops and conference talks ask me all the time about these two methods. So let's answer these questions once and for all in this video. But before we start, if this is your first time here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and all types of other Java persistence related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, let's get into today's topic. The implementation of the equals and hashcode methods for entity classes is an often discussed question. Do you really need them? There are lots of applications that work perfectly fine using Java's default methods provided by the object class. And if you need to implement them, how should you do that? Should you use all attributes or just the primary key? Let's start with the most important questions. When and why do you need to implement the equals and hashcode methods? As so often in software development, the correct answer to these questions is, it depends. If you take a look at the JPA specification, you will be surprised to only find two explicit and one implicit mention of both methods. You need to implement the equals and hashcode methods for primary key classes if you map composite primary keys. If you map an association to a map, your map key needs to implement the equals and hashcode methods. So, if you use an entity as the key, it needs to provide both methods. You can map one to many and many to many associations to different subtypes of a collection. If you use a set, your entities have to have equals and hashcode methods. Unfortunately, only the first reference provides a clear indication that you need to implement equals and hashcode methods for primary key classes. Otherwise, two different instances of your primary key object that have the same attribute values would be equal in the database, but not in your Java code. That would obviously create a lot of problems, but it doesn't answer the question if you need to implement these methods for your entity classes. The object class already provides a default implementation of these methods. Are they good enough, or do you need to override them? Under the following circumstances, objects, equals, and hashcode methods are not good enough. Java's default implementation of the equals and hashcode methods are based on the object's identity. That means that no two objects are equal and all of them have a different hashcode value. Hibernate makes sure to return the same object if you read the same entity twice within a session. Due to this, the default equals and hashcode implementations are okay as long as an entity stays in the context of one session. So in the following example, E1 and E2 are the same objects and the equals method therefore returns true. But that changes as soon as you work with multiple sessions or detach and merge an entity, for example, by sending it to or retrieving it from a remote client. In the following example, I detach E1 before I fetch E2. Hibernate then instantiates a new object for E2. Based on Java's default implementation, E1 and E2 are no longer equal, even so they represent the same database record. As you can see, Java's default equals and hashcode methods only produce the required result if the Hibernate session ensures that there is only one Java object that represents a specific record in the database table. If you load your entities in multiple sessions, or if you work with detached entities, you need to override these methods. In all other cases, it's better to rely on Java's default implementation. Java's language specification defines strict contracts for the equals and hashcode methods. You can find them in the Java doc of the object class. If you override these methods, you need to make sure that your implementation fulfills these contracts. Here's the contract defined for the equals method. It is reflexive for any non-null reference value x, x equals x should return true. It is symmetric for any non-null reference values x and y, x equals y should return true if and only if y equals x returns true. It is transitive for any non-null reference values x, y, and z. If x equals y returns true and y equals z returns true, then x equals z should return true. It is consistent for any non-null reference values x and y, multiple invocations of x equals y consistently returns true or consistently returns false, provided no information used in equals comparisons on the objects is modified. For any non-null reference value x, x equals null should return false. This is a copy of Java's equals contract, so you are probably already familiar with it and implement it several times for all kinds of Java classes. But if you implement it for a JPA entity, you need to pay special attention to part 4 of the contract. It requires you to write the equals method in a way that multiple invocations of it return the same value. This gets also enforced by the set interface. Great care must be exercised if mutable objects are used as set elements. The behavior of a set is not specified if the value of an object is changed in a manner that affects equals comparisons while the object is an element in the set. That is a challenge if you use generated primary keys, because the identifying attribute of the object changes when it transitions from lifecycle state transient to managed. But more about that later. The HashCode contract is a little bit easier to implement. Whenever it is invoked on the same object more than once during an execution of a Java application, the HashCode method must consistently return the same integer, provided no information used in equals comparisons on the object is modified. This integer need not remain consistent from one execution of an application to another execution of the same application. If two objects are equal according to the equals method, then calling the HashCode method on each of the two objects must produce the same integer result. It is not required that if two objects are unequal according to the equals method, then calling the HashCode method on each of the two objects must produce distinct integer results. However, the programmer should be aware that producing distinct integer results for unequal objects may improve the performance of hash tables. The important part of this contract is that the HashCode has to be consistent with the result of the equals method. As you will see in the following paragraphs, that's relatively easy to achieve. An entity object represents a record in a database table. Each of these records is identified by a unique primary key value, and some of them also have a unique business key. So it shouldn't be a surprise if I tell you that you can use these values in your equals and HashCode implementation. The complexity of this implementation depends on the kind of key that's available for your entity. The implementation of your equals and HashCode methods is pretty easy if your entity has a mandatory business or natural key. As long as this key is immutable and gets always set during the creation of the entity object, you can base your implementation on it. And because the key identifies the object, you don't need to include any other entity attributes in your equals or HashCode method. Here you can see an example that provides an equals and HashCode implementation based on the string business key attribute. I also annotated the business key attribute with Hibernate's natural ID annotation. This annotation is optional, but I highly recommend to use it with all natural IDs. It enables Hibernate support for natural ID columns, which makes it a lot easier to load these entities by their natural identifier. Please note that the only public constructor of the MyEntity class requires a value for the business key attribute. The NoArgs constructor is private. This is a Hibernate-specific implementation that's not supported by the JPA specification. It ensures that the business key attribute is always set and that the HashCode of the object will not change. If you want to implement this in a JPA-compliant way, you need to provide a public or protected NoArgs constructor. You then need to accept that the HashCode of the object changes when you set the business key attribute, or you need to use a fixed HashCode as I do for generated primary key values. In general, a changed HashCode doesn't create any problems as long as you set the value of the business key attribute before you add the entity object to any set. If you use a business key, it happens quite often that it's only unique if you combine it with a reference to a parent entity. You then need to fetch the parent association eager, include the hashcode of the parent entity in your hashcode calculation, and also check the equality of the reference parent objects in your equals method. Here you can see an example that includes the associated myParent object in the equals and hashcode methods. If you manage your primary key values programmatically, you can implement your equals and hashcode methods in almost the same way as I showed you in the previous example. The only requirement here is that you set the primary key value in the constructor or immediately after you instantiated a new entity object. As I teased earlier, generated primary keys create a problem for the implementation of your equals and hashcode methods. That's because the primary key value gets set when the entity gets persisted. So your entity object can exist with and without a primary key value. The challenge here is that the hashcode of your entity isn't allowed to change after you added the object to a set, so you can't use the primary key to calculate the hashcode. You need to return a fixed value that's the same for all objects of the entity class. That, of course, negatively affects the performance of very huge sets and maps because they put all objects into the same hash bucket. But Hibernate can't efficiently manage huge associations anyway, and you should avoid them in general. Here you can see an implementation that uses the primary key value in the equals method and returns a fixed value as the hashcode. The implementation of the equals and hashcode methods for Hibernate entities is an often discussed topic that provides an interesting technical challenge. But as I explained at the beginning of this video, you only need to override object's default implementation if you work with multiple Hibernate sessions or with detached entities. For all other applications, the default implementation works perfectly fine. If you decide to provide your own equals and hashcode implementations, you need to make sure that your code fulfills the contracts defined by the Java language and that the hashcode of your objects doesn't change when the entity gets persisted. The implementation of these methods therefore depends on the different keys available for your entity and how you set their values. If your entity has a business key or a natural ID, you can use it within your equals and hashcode method. If you set your primary key values programmatically, you can use its value in your equals check and when you calculate the hashcode. If you tell Hibernate to generate your primary key values, you need to use a fixed hashcode and your equals method requires explicit handling of null values. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about using native queries with JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!